a realistic, more optimistic end of the spectrum, so to speak, for the next 12 years or so of gerontology research, and in particular biomedical gerontology research, trying to actually develop ways to postpone aging, would be that we would have demonstrated in mice the ability to perform truly comprehensive rejuvenation. In other words, we would be able to take mice that are already, let's say, two-thirds of the way through their natural lifespan, and in particular, mice that have nothing particularly wrong with them other than the fact that they're mice. In other words, they live relatively long and healthy lives compared to other mice. And to apply a bunch of therapies to those mice which extend their remaining lifespan by at least a factor of two, or ideally more like a factor of three. So in actual numbers, what we would be saying here is we'd take mice whose normal lifespan is something like 3 years, and we would do nothing at all to them until they were about 2 years old, and the result of the therapies that we administered would be that they would live maybe 4 or 5 years. I think that all of the cellular and molecular interventions that ought to be necessary in order to allow that outcome are in line to be in place by 2025. Of course, each of them still has obstacles to surmount, and so there's some chance that each of them would not actually occur. And of course, one of the biggest obstacles of all is that those obstacles will only be surmounted if enough manpower and general funding is allocated to the relevant research. There are a lot of ifs in that, but I still think that it's a realistic outcome that within, I'd say, 8 or 10 years, and therefore with that much higher probability within 12 years, we will actually get to that point. That's a point which I have previously called robust mouse rejuvenation. And the reason I single it out is because I feel that that's the kind of spectacularness of results that we're going to need in order to really put paid to society's prevailing pessimism and fatalism with regard to human aging. I think if we can do that well with mice that are already in middle age before we do anything to them, no one is going to be able to carry on believing that the end of human aging will never occur. Everyone's going to know that it's only a matter of time before we really manage the same for human beings, and indeed before we manage more than that for human beings. So that's why I think it's the critical thing. What I'm doing, and what SENS Research Foundation, the organization that's been created around my work, is doing to make this happen and to maximize the probability that each of these component things will actually occur, is, first of all, we are doing and or funding the relevant research. We have a few thousand square feet of lab space in Mountain View, California, where three of our major projects are being undertaken. And we have now more than a dozen projects supported in university labs around the world doing a wide range of other things. Of course, we're not the only people doing this kind of work. There are some areas of rejuvenation research, as I'd like to call it, which are being undertaken very assiduously elsewhere. But unfortunately, there are several which are not, which are still very poorly appreciated and are still neglected, perhaps just because they seem too hard. And that's really the number one reason why SENS Research Foundation exists, so that these things are not neglected. The other thing that we're doing is, of course, outreach and advocacy. We are constantly going out there, both on the website and me traveling around giving talks, and of course, increasingly my colleagues doing the same, and of course, interviews like this for that matter, making sure that people understand both the feasibility and the desirability of relatively near-term progress in the postponement of age-related ill health. It's always seemed to me that we need to attack both of those things in terms of what the public actually thinks, public pessimism on this, in order to really change people's attitudes and get people to pay attention when breakthroughs are made. The more progress we make in educating society that these things are possible and desirable, the less dramatic a breakthrough will be needed in a lab in order to really open the funding floodgates. The breakthroughs that are needed are in some cases being worked on in parallel in different ways by different research groups around the world, and all of those groups have some claim or other to doing the most promising thing. We won't know until we try, so it would be very hard to know. But some of these areas, as I mentioned, are still being worked on hardly by anybody, in many cases really only by us. Now, of course, as interim very preliminary results, even results not even in mice but in cell culture, are achieved, the interest that certain research groups will have in taking them forward will correspondingly increase. And so I would certainly hope that by the time we get all of these things working in mice, that will have been achieved as a collaboration not just with SENS Foundation, but also with a wide range of research groups around the world. There's quite a lot going on right now in the lab, and a lot of it gets reported in somewhat breathless terms. The most recent report that got an enormous amount of airtime was from David Sinclair, my friend, who's a prominent researcher at Harvard, of course, showing rejuvenation of mitochondrial function in mice that were given a particular chemical named NAD+, which David's been working on for a long time. I think it's important to understand that this was not a lifespan study. These mice were not actually shown to live longer as a result of this rejuvenation. And indeed, there has been prior work over the past decade or more showing by other means that it's possible to rejuvenate mitochondrial function in old rodents, and that has not been shown to increase longevity. So we shouldn't get too excited about this. But at the same time, every trick that we can assemble that allows us to manipulate the metabolism of old animals, especially old mammals, is another string to our bow, another thing that we have to consider as potentially contributing to eventual progress. My view is that it's impossible really to say whether feasibility or desirability of the defeat of aging in the public eye is the bigger problem, because the two problems are so interlinked with each other. In other words, I think that if we were to improve people's appreciation that it would be a good thing to treat aging, then we would find it much more straightforward to convince people to pay attention to the breakthroughs that are being made and to advocate for greater research funding to accelerate that progress. Conversely, if people believed that all of this was possible, then they would give much less airtime to people who say indefensible things about the desirability of aging. So these two things are really intertwined. It's very easy in any pioneering technological research area for most people to believe that there's nothing that they can actually do to help. In fact, I was guilty of this myself a long time ago. When I was working in artificial intelligence research, the basic reason why I wasn't working on aging was not because I didn't yet think that aging was an important problem, even more important than automation, but rather because I presumed that since I didn't have training in biology, there was no point in my trying to get involved. So now what I want to say to everybody is it doesn't matter who you are, it doesn't matter what your skills are, there's always something you can do. Clearly, wealthy people can support the research directly with finances, and biologists can support the research directly by going into particular research projects and research programs that are relevant to this mission. But everyone who is not in those categories can also help, either by doing what you're doing right now, putting me on camera, or by inviting me or my colleagues, other people, to give lectures, or just by advocacy in their own world, you know, talking to their family, talking to their friends and their colleagues, and generally raising the quality of debate in all of this area, so that people's understanding of how rapidly progress is being made and of how important that progress is can accelerate.